Good afternoon, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank IAG and Dr. Krishna Kumar for giving me the opportunity to talk on this very important topic, hysteroscopy for RPOC. Retained part of conception is a very common clinical problem in our OPDs, be it following pregnancy termination or after the deliveries. Now, use of hysteroscopy for retained products gives us wonderful results in terms of completion of procedure, as well as reducing the need for repeat procedure and prevention of intrauterine adhesions. This procedure should be implemented for all cases where retained products are suspected, and this improves the reproductive outcome for women who are looking for pregnancy in future as well. RPOC is defined as the tissue inside the uterine cavity after delivery or termination of pregnancy. RPOC complicates 1% of deliveries and can be seen after medical or surgical termination or spontaneous miscarriage, and also after vaginal and cesarean deliveries. How these patients present to us in our outpatient settings? They present to us vaginal bleeding following the MTP pills or following their deliveries. They may have abnormal uterine bleeding following the termination, continuous or on and off spotting, amenorrhea, pelvic pain, fever, or abnormal vaginal discharge. Most patients with RPOC present with vaginal bleeding within days to weeks following pregnancy resolution. However, RPOC have been found to persist in patients for multiple years. What are the challenges we face in these cases? As there are no clearly defined diagnostic criteria, no set protocols, no evidence-based guidelines, and there are no defined treatment protocols. So most of the practitioners resort to dilatation and curettage for these cases, which can be avoided, and there can be a transition in practice from this procedure to hysteroscopic guided procedure. And we also know that when we do procedure for RPOC and send it for histopathology confirmation, out of 100 cases, only 50 to 88% show retained product of conception. So is it justified to do DNC or the curettage in the cases where RPOC is not there? Why not have a look and see and treat? Now, dilatation and curettage is an age-old treatment. It is a blind procedure, all of us know that. It causes infection, uterine perforation, high rate of incomplete procedure, and need for repeat procedure that may be up to 20.8%. Now, how we can decide the complexity of procedure and how we can be well prepared? If we look at the Gutenberg classification of RPOC, this is an ultrasonographic classification where type 0 is classified as hyperechogenic avascular mass, type 1 is different echoes with minimal or no vascularity, highly vascularized mass confined to the cavity, and type 3 is highly vascularized mass with highly vascularized myometrium. Now, when this is projected to hysteroscopic findings, so we in type A or type 0, we have white mass with no clear structures. Type 1, well-defined avascular chorionic villi. Type 2, well-vascularized chorionic villi. And type 3 is aneurysm over myometrium in the implantation area, which is sometimes misinterpreted as arteriovenous malformation. And hysteroscopy is an answer where we can differentiate between arteriovenous malformation and a type 3 RPOC. Now, dilatation and curettage is a blind procedure. It can cause intrauterine adhesions in 30% of the procedures. Another study has shown it can cause intrauterine adhesions in 21 to 66% of procedure, which was published by our friend Alonso in 2019 in Facts versus in Facts Views of Gynae. Now, if we look at dilatation and curettage, which many of my colleagues will say, why can't we do it under ultrasonographic guidance? No direct visualization, even if you do it under ultrasound guidance, and the curettage will still remain global and not focal. So we are going to curette all the walls of the cavity, even if we're doing it under ultrasound guidance, and the rate of intrauterine adhesions may remain same, which can be reduced by hysteroscopic procedure. Various studies have shown operative hysteroscopy is associated with increased surgical success and decreased post-operative formation of intrauterine adhesions. Now, when we are talking of intrauterine adhesions, if we understand the pathophysiology, we are more justified in propagating hysteroscopy for RPOC. Ashamans occur when trauma to or removal of the basal layer of endometrium in opposing areas occurs within the uterine cavity. And this type of injury to the lining triggers inflammation that allows these adhesive bands to form from one side of the cavity to the other. Now, if you look at this picture, and when we are doing the curettage, curette is removing the endometrium and a part of the myometrium. Also, this area becomes raw and there are adhesive band formation between the anterior and posterior uterine walls. Now, this is the endometrium, the basal layer, and the myometrium. If this is the level of damage, more risk of intrauterine adhesions resulting in Usherman syndrome. It can occur in up to 13% of women undergoing termination of pregnancy during the first trimester and 30% in women undergoing a dilatation and curettage after a late spontaneous abortion. The incidence may be as high as 23.4% in patients undergoing procedures 2 to 4 weeks after the initial procedure for a vaginal delivery or missed abortion. The risk increases for patients undergoing repeated procedures for bleeding or repeated elective termination of pregnancies. What are the advantages when we use operative hysteroscopy for retained product of conception? We can see and treat. It is not a blind procedure. There is direct visualization, precise and targeted removal of RPOC as compared to the global curettage, which is done in DNC. No damage to myometrium, less chances of developing intrauterine adhesion. It is 12.8% versus 29.6% when we compare it to dilatation and curettage. Now, how do we do this procedure? It is as simple as other hysteroscopic procedures. If you are using a Betocci's hysteroscope or a 2.9 millimeter hysteroscope, it can be done in the office setting without any anesthesia, especially for type 0 and type 1 RPOCs. We usually do vaginoscopy followed by hysteroscopy in all the cases. In this case, we have used Betocci's hysteroscope, and we are going to remove RPOC by cold scissors. Active electrode we avoid to use in these cases if not required or if there is no bleeding. Another advantage of hysteroscopy guided procedure is we can also look at the rest of the cavity, can rule out other pathologies such as subseptum, polyps, and other causes which may contribute to miscarriages or early trimester miscarriages in many of these women. Now, cold scissors is a very useful tool. You can just start detaching it from the attachment to the uterine wall. There is no curettage to the other walls, no damage to the myometrium in these cases. And you can use a simple 5 French forceps to remove these RPOCs, and procedure can be completed in the outpatient setting as well. Now, this is the forceps. We can use this forceps to remove the retained product of conception, and there is no need of any active electrode in most of the cases. And this can be done with cold scissors only. Now, this is the RPOC which we removed with the help of hysteroscope, and the procedure was completed in the single sitting. For some cases, we also use cold loop or the resectoscopic loop. In our practice, when the advanced gestation is there, when the cervix is already dilated and there is a leakage of distension media with a small scope, I prefer to use a loop but without an active electrode. And when RPOC is quite fluffy and more in amount, the cold loop helps us removing the retained product successfully. You can see these pieces coming out beautifully, and there is no damage to the endometrium or myometrium. And this can be done in several strokes if needed. When the RPOC is quite extensive, when the gestation is advanced, definitely the retained product will be little more as compared to the early gestation, or when you are doing it for procedures where they have taken pills and a small RPOC is there. So this is the RPOC successfully removed with the help of cold loop without using any energy source. Another way of doing it is by using a hysteroscopic morcellator. We have TrueClear system, we have Bugatti shaver. It all depends on the expertise and the availability of equipment, which method you are more comfortable with and which method you are going to use. Now, hysteroscopic morcellator, which is being used for polyps and fibroids, can also be used for retained product of conception. The advantage is less learning curve and easy procedure, availability of equipment and expertise is required. If we compare hysteroscopy versus curettage, in hysteroscopy, we visualize the complete uterine cavity, always complete removal of RPOC. It is targeted as opposed to global curettage of the uterine walls. Reduced trauma to the uterine walls, leading to reduced rates of post-operative intrauterine adhesions. Young women who likely to conceive in future, the prevention of intrauterine adhesions, which could affect fertility, is of prime importance in this population. Additional advantages of this procedure, we also use this procedure in missed miscarriages, where we may get to see the complete fetus and very early structural abnormalities can be picked up, and also embryo fetoscopy can be performed. It also helps in detecting other pathologies which could be missed otherwise. If you see this video, in this she had a miscarriage at around 9 to 10 weeks of pregnancy, and instead of giving pills, we directly posted her for hysteroscopy, so that we could see the fetus structurally, if any structural abnormalities are there or not. Once they expel out or we do a DNC, for these, we cannot examine the fetus completely. And there may be a chance that we may miss some of the important information. So this is a very good tool for us, where we can utilize it for multiple purposes, for cases of missed miscarriages and retained product of conception. This was a recent publication on surgical and reproductive outcomes after hysteroscopic removal of retained product of conception. And it has shown us that there is a high rate of completely removing RPOC, low complication rates, fecundity seems reassuring with appropriate clinical pregnancy and live birth rates, standardization of approach and comparative trials of different hysteroscopic approaches are needed. If my colleagues ask me which method is better or which is superior to the other, it's difficult to answer. As I already said, depending on the expertise and depending on the equipment, you can either use scissors and forceps or a loop in a cold way or a hysteroscopic morcellator. A loop with an active electrode can be used for type 2 and type 3 of RPOCs, where there is a vascularity and you may need to coagulate a vessel. Thank you. I would like to say there is no planet B. Likewise, there is no uterus B. We have to be judicious. We have to be taking care of the outcomes or the reproductive outcomes whenever we operate on the uterus. So RPOC is a procedure which can be done by hysteroscopic guidance, and for the future good outcomes for the women and good fecundity rates, RPOCs, all the procedures being done by curettage should be shifted to hysteroscopic approach. Thank you. I would like to thank ISG again for giving me the opportunity to speak on this very important topic. Thank you.